For those of you that don't know who Helen is, Helena B. Scott is an international author, historian and linguist and initiator of the mysteries. As a light trans and mental medium with a strong spiritual connection, Helena is a member of the Ghost Club, the world's oldest paranormal research society established in 1862 and the London College of Psychic Studies established in 1884, where she lectures as a specialist on the Knights Templar, author of the only comprehensive study featuring in the secret history and physical research on Ireland's most haunted house, Loftus Hall, Loftus the Hall of Dreams, Amazon bestseller in Freemasonry, Secret Societies and Occultism. Formerly known as Redmond Hall, this haunted estate on land once belonging to the Knights Templar features esoteric architecture. So Helena works in secret history, historical revisionism, aiming to unveil overlooked aspects intentionally omitted or forgotten, such as ancient wisdom. Her mission goes beyond historical revisionism. She seeks to give a voice to the voiceless, including women in history and those unjustly persecuted, such as the Gnostic groups like the Cathar and Knights Templar, specializing in medieval history, symbolism, Freemasonry and secret societies, and the Western esoteric tradition. Helena's research revives Ireland's relevance in the context of ancient knowledge and sacred energies. Helena is multilingual and is not limited by language barriers in her research, being a native speaker of both English and Spanish, and working with French, Italian, Catalan, Portuguese, or having sound knowledge of German and Swedish. Her language skills extend to dead languages like Latin, Hebrew, Old Norse, and hieroglyphs. In her exploration of symbolism and medieval graffiti, she is well versed in early writing systems. You can discover more about Helena and her work, as well as upcoming events on her website, www.helenabscott.com, Facebook and YouTube, where she shares captivating episodes of her travel research vlog and insightful lectures on the Knights Templar. So Helena, in your history work of unearthing the forgotten aspects of history, such as the important women of history, and those who were persecuted, such as the Gnostics and the Knights Templar, you're very familiar with symbolism, the Knights Templar and their way of life, winemaking and medical knowledge. Could you go into this and your knowledge of St. Helena and what made you resonate with her?
Yes, and I'm going to show the bottle there. You see Helena there, and you're just waking up, you're having breakfast, and it's 10:30 over here, and I'm having a glass of wine, as you can see. I will be having it in a minute, but that's her. So, firstly, I want to say that, as you can all see, I'm a woman, or at least I think I look like a woman anyway, and I'm also a historian who works in secret history, what is known as shadow history or historical revisionism. And what that is unearthing evidence and carrying out research of a revisionist interpretation of history. So basically, anything that has been omitted, whether on purpose or overlooked or forgotten, or that has been really deliberately suppressed, especially by or ignored by established scholars, that happens a lot. So I like to be, play the role of justice, maybe that's a way of saying it, but I like to be neutral and fair. And I think history is written by the winners usually, so a lot of things get left out. So that's why I went into this area of history, really. And I also, because to be honest, and I don't like saying anything against my colleagues, but many historians like to parrot history. And are very comfortable being what I call armchair historians from home, Googling or searching on databases, or, you know, with a nice book by the fire or research, and like to criticize those of us who actually do find evidence, because we do go out there and research and get wet and fracture legs and all sorts of wonderful things, you know. I'm still recovering from a double leg fracture. So, you know, those of us who go out there and stay from dusk till dawn, spending every penny of our pockets, funding our own research, or dragging our kids, I have to mention my son in this, for justice and for truth, which is what was embodied by St. Helena, really, because she represents many things for the Templars, and she's very important to them. But she was a woman who went on an expedition in her late age. I don't know if she was, some people say 70, others say 80, and she discovered the relics of the true cross and the nails of Christ. And she was driven by a love for Sophia, for knowledge. So she's also, by the way, I keep forgetting, Helena, thank you for reminding me, but she's also the world's first archaeologist. So, I mean, being a historian and a woman, I had to do a wine as a tribute to her. And of course, the Templars dedicated many chapels to her, and they revered the Divine Feminine, which I'll go into afterwards. Mary Magdalene and St. Helena being some of the top females that were important to them. So that's what resonated with me. And also, I like to say that in my work in secret history, I give a voice to the voiceless in history. And I think the first victim of history, or voiceless itself, is history itself. And then women as well. And of course, the persecuted, the Agnus Dei. And in that, I wanted to do today, for me it was special to do today, and thank you for asking me, because I feel that the Gnostics have been persecuted throughout history, from the earliest of times. And even nowadays, I mean, we have, you know, freedom of faith and to choose and so on. And Gnosticism isn't a faith per se. It's more, I would describe it as an underlying stream of philosophy, of knowledge, of Gnosis. But so many people, you know, get very touchy on the subject of faith, you know. Mm. And I think it's so important to allow freedom to choose. So that's another victim there. That's another voiceless. So I'm very blessed, I feel, and especially now it's Easter. You know, today I actually made my son watch, I don't know if you'll think it's a good thing or a bad thing, but Netflix has this series on Moses. And after making him watch one of your episodes on The Bible's Biggest Lie, I got him to watch Moses with me. And it's kind of, you know, it's kind of gotten to me, you know, maybe now that I've turned 48, that it's really, you know, we have to stand up for what is right. We have to stand up for what we believe in. So for me, justice in history is a big one. So that's what resonated with me, with her, with the Templars, and with Gnosticism as well. And like I was saying, women have been victims in history. The first silence victims, if you will, and the feminine aspect of God, Sophia, the Shekinah. And that was key to the Templars. So that's why I've also done a book that, you know, it's coming out soon, The Way of the Rose. And there'll be a little video that I'll be showing afterwards here on the divine feminine aspects of the Knights Templar, because they were trying to bring that back that has been suppressed from life, you know. And I think that was a very important job that they had. So the place that St. Helena found, or rather the place where she found the cross and the nails of Christ, later became, as you know, the location of the Holy Sepulchre. There's a church built there, and it would become a place of pilgrimage. And, well, we're Easter week. I think it's important to talk about those things. I feel like I'm doing a seasonal program here. But it's connected to the Knights Templar, and I want to mention a particular figure right now, Godfrey of Bouillon, okay? Leading crusader and elected defender of Jerusalem following the First Crusade. He's important because he sets up two military orders in Jerusalem. Among the first, I would say, the Equestrian Order of the Holy Sepulchre in 1098 to protect the holy relics, and the Order of the Priory of Our Lady at Mount Sion in 1099 to protect the bloodline, supposedly. What isn't mentioned, and this is secret history, as I say, is that Godfrey of Bouillon, even though he's not mentioned as a founding Knights Templar, was instrumental in the founding of the order, even if he died in 1100, because we're told that the Knights Templar were founded in 1118, officially, perhaps, but unofficially, they existed much before that. And we do have evidence of that. There's a strong case for the existence of the order before, because we have letters that still exist from the Bishop of Chartres to Count Hugh, begging him basically not to abandon his wife for the order of the temple, with those words, in 1114. I believe there's an earlier letter from 1110 as well. So that's a record right there that we have. But there's other evidence that we have that suggests that the order was founded much earlier, and I will be mentioning that in my book. However, I'm mentioning Godfrey, and today I'm here to talk about Templar spirituality and how that came to be. And I've been mentioning women, and I have to mention another woman now that's relevant to everything that happened with the order and spirituality as well. Godfrey's aunt, Matilda of Tuscany. Matilda of Tuscany, a lot of people don't know this, but she actually founded the world's first military order. I believe it was 1060, the order of Altopascio, St. James of Altopascio in Italy. That was the first order ever founded by a woman, a military order founded by a woman. Yes, I'm bringing all the women back from history. So I will burn at the stake for that. I know I will. But she's important because I'm doing a little side project with her, which I might give some sneak previews. But it has to do with the cover of my upcoming book. And she also founded 100 monasteries, but she is believed to have provided the funds to the Priory of Sion. And why am I ranting on about this? Because some people believe, some scholars believe, and I would agree with this, that the Knights Templar, regardless of when they were founded, officially or unofficially, that they came from the Priory of Sion, from those knights that were in the Priory of Sion. So we can trace directly to Godfrey's family through his aunt and through him, the beginnings of the order. And I think that's quite important, especially if we look at his lineage and his roots. I always say that roots matter. And roots matter when we come to understand the faith of the Templars, because a lot of things have been thrown around. The Templars were Catholic. The Catholic Church would like that now, wouldn't they?
Well, they certainly would.
But, you know, truth is stranger than fiction. And truth is always, you know, unexpected as well. They were not Catholic. Some of them could have been, and I'm going to go into that in a minute, but they were not. And I am very proud to say that the Knights Templar were part of something bigger that I believe in, which was the preserving of knowledge, of Gnosis, the Gnostic traditions. And I think we have to thank them in many ways because they have contributed to preserving the Gnostic traditions, the Gnostic customs, Gnosticism today even, you know. So I think that's one thing that is not mentioned and I wanted to say. But going back to the Templars and wine, because this is very relevant, Matilda here, Godfrey's aunt, was also known for having won a strategic battle, okay, with wine that actually she became famous for afterwards, Lambrusco wine, the famous Italian Frizzante Lambrusco wine. Well, you owe that to Godfrey's aunt. So next time you lift a glass of Lambrusco, remember her. So she had an interesting battle with that, and she, I'll explain it another day because there's plenty to go into. But wine is important to the Templars because there's a very critical connection between them and wine. And this is key to understanding their origins and where they come from. Now, I've done a series of lectures and wine zooms and all sorts of things on wine. And I've this wine that I've been holding and ranting on about, because I like to bring things back from history, like women and other things, and things that are useful, teachings, ancient ways that can enhance our modern lives. I unearthed a medieval recipe for a medieval wine that would have been drunk and made by the Templars, which has spikenard in it, spikenard used by Mary Magdalene, which has medicinal properties. Now, the Templars grew herbs. The Templars and the Cistercians have written very, I would say, significant studies on plants and their effects on the human body as well. And in fact, there is a workshop that I teach on Templar healing arts and practices. So that's something if you guys are interested. And they would use spikenard, they would use other herbs. And I created a wine just to bring back that Templar tradition. And I made it with wine from the vineyards of Tomar that would have belonged to the Knights Templar there in Portugal, with a modern Knights Templar order. So just to continue a tradition. But why? Why am I ranting on about wine? Well, the bloodline, remember the question, the Holy Sepulchre order by Godfrey of Bouillon, okay? And the prior is signed to protect the bloodline. So the bloodline from James the Just was called the vine because the Bible classifies the descendants of Israel as a vine. The line of Judah being described at some length as the Lord's cherished plant, Isaiah 5:7. Jesus later proclaimed, "I am the true vine," John 15:1. I recently launched this Templar wine, which I've been showing you, because I saw the connections between the Templars and their bloodline and the vine and wine throughout history, overlooked by most historians. And one of the things, I have a little video to show in a moment, if that's okay, just to show people what my work has been in the Templars. But the Templars didn't just make wine and export it. They actually, in Southern Europe, where obviously vines grew, they would build their preceptories and build, sorry, build, they would build the preceptories either near vineyards or create vineyards. And in fact, they were responsible for preserving many of the vines that were brought to Europe by the Phoenicians. So the modern wines that we have today, some of them, we do owe those wines also to the Templars. And who was Templar lineage? And who was I talking about before? Godfrey of Bouillon and Matilda, his aunt Matilda.
Matilda
So,
of Gascony.
yes, waltzing Matildas, there's a story there. But I'm researching a couple of Matildas with in connection to that. But wine is very relevant, okay? So because of this, and I'd like to add a little bit more. Wine was always used also, the Christians used grape juice, which is the wine in communion. Now, you're a priest, Nathan, so you will know all about this. It not only represents the blood of Jesus enacted as a threshold, but it represents the origins of the Knights Templar themselves from the bloodline of James and Jesus the Just. So, you cannot have wine without Templars, honestly. So, the lineage of Jesus the Just is believed to extend through historical figures such as the Fisher Kings and Lancelot, ultimately descending to the Merovingian kings of France. This lineage included notable figures like Charlemagne and Princess Bertha, and led to Godfrey of Bouillon, which is why I mentioned him in the first place, who founded the Equestrian Order of the Holy Sepulchre and the Order of Sion. Now, as I mentioned, when he died in 1100s and is never mentioned as the founder of the Knights Templar, for me, he has everything to do with their beginnings. Godfrey's line continued through the Stuarts, the marriage of a daughter of King Robert the Bruce, Marjorie Bruce, and Walter, the High Steward of Scotland, would give rise to the House of Stuart through their son Robert II. So due to this and the fact that wine and tempers go together, I launched that wine, which we'll see in a minute. Pimmin, it's called Pimmin Medieval Spice Wine, dedicated to St. Helena. And as I said, it was recreated with the modern Templar order. It contains a sacred spikenard that was used by Mary Magdalene in anointing Jesus and anointing the Christ, which is not what people think, but we'll go into that maybe in another YouTube about the heroes, gammas, and all of that. So, and I tried to recreate it with the same medieval ingredients and in the same way. I wanted to bring back a truly historic product that was made and drunk by Templars, but also written about by Templars, such as Teutonic Knight Wolfram von Eschenbach in his Parsifal romance. And I wanted to accurately reproduce the taste, but also with the herbs, like I mentioned, that would have been grown or used by the Knights Templar in their healing remedies. So with this, if I'm allowed to share my screen, I'd like to share a little video for everybody. And let me just see if this works. Right. And forgive me, I have got to go to the top of my presentation here. One second. Okay. You're seeing that, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Wine history with regards to the Templars has been very neglected and people don't really know enough about it, even though we do have records, we do have the history, it's recorded in many areas, it's a very rich history. And I was telling Andy, that we owe the Knights Templar a lot, because this glass of wine that I have here today would probably not be here today if it wasn't for the Knights Templar, because not only did they make wine and import wine, and a lot of people don't know that near their preceptories, they would actually plant vineyards and each preceptory would make their own wine, which would be consumed by the Knights Templar in moderate small quantities, but they did drink wine. There's a lot of confusion with that, and then they would export it. But they also revived and planted some of the vines that the Phoenicians brought us to Europe. And they developed techniques like moutage and all these things, which I'm going to ask you. So we owe so much. I get very excited, you know, because I think we owe so much to the Knights Templar and the wine, the elixir, the nectar of the gods that we drink today. So could you tell us a little bit more about the vineyard, please?
Yes, our vineyards in Tomare, they are around 17 hectares, mm-hmm. where we have Portuguese grape varieties as well as international.
Right.
And the idea of the international grape varieties was to express that connection with the Knight Templars, because they came from from outside Portugal to Portugal, so yes. They bring also their own varieties, and they cultivate it here in Portugal. So it's important to have that and to acknowledge that. And they always, and for me it's fascinating because they always focus a lot on knowledge. They yes, want to know more. And well, sometimes we start a conversation about wine, mm-hmm. and other things start to appear in our minds. Mm-hmm. And for me, mm-hmm. when I think the Knights Templars, you have to remember also they give the order of Christ mm-hmm. in Portugal to yes. develop all the knowledge. And the ships to go everywhere in the world, they were based on the knowledge of the Knights Templars. Because they were the order in Portugal. We kept all the goods, and we didn't pursue them. In fact, we received several from Europe mm-hmm. because that knowledge was important. Mm-hmm. And specifically about the vineyards, I have.
So that was that. One second, let me just get out of here. There you go. So I think you have more questions for me.
yes, indeed. I also want to point out something as well, was a quote that I really liked that you mentioned. Instead of history, her story.
Exactly. Let's bring that back. Her story, yes. The Bible's hidden goddess too.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so question number two. Due to your knowledge and skills of decoding symbolism, you're able to understand the hidden language of the Gnostics and the Knights Templar, encoded in their myths and in stone, to ensure the survival of Gnosis. Could you please discuss your thoughts on the language of mysteries and the green language of mystery? Sorry if I butchered this one. La langue verte?
La langue verte. Yes. Yeah, the language of the birds as well. Yes. So let me move this bar, which is annoying me. Forgive me for this. People can see my techno peasant skills. I'll just put the current slide because I have a few slides here to be commenting, if that's okay. So can you see that bar on your end? Or is it just me that I'm just seeing it?
I see reading, but the only problem is on this side here, I can see my camera, which cuts out. I believe it might be rich.
Well, it's down there, so it should be fine now. So anyway, so the green language of initiation is important because during the times that the Templars lived, and even early in history, few people could read and write. That's the first thing, okay? And this was controlled by the church later on, and even women were not allowed to read or interpret the Bible. I was reading about the Beguines the other day, and they were not allowed to read the Bible. I just thought, what crazy things, you know? But anyway, so few people could understand stone carvings and oral stories told to them. So therefore, important messages were conveyed usually by visual cues, such as carvings that we see, decorations on churches, drawings, artwork, and so on, but also orally, with the tales that we have by bards, by troubadours, from mouth to mouth. So, however, Gnostics at the time, and anything and anyone that fell outside the agreed narrative of the Church of Rome, have been persecuted throughout history, unfortunately. So there was a need, in order to communicate safely and preserve wisdom, Gnosis, to come up with an alternative and safe way of doing so. One that would allow for an esoteric interpretation by initiates, depending on their level of knowledge, and one that would mask them and would provide the exoteric meaning, in other words, the meaning for the public. These are the two main factors as to the development and use of a secret language of initiation since the earliest of times, a language that would be known as the green language of initiation, or la langue verte, also the language of the birds, or the language of the troubadours later on, in which the Knights Templar were fluent in as initiates of the mysteries and Gnostics. What does this mean? I keep going on about the mysteries. I'll explain that in a minute. Therefore, all of this could not be expressed. All that could not be expressed was encoded in this hidden language. It could not be expressed outward, as the church was destroying the true Christian faith that the Templars carried within. One can see how the Templars, who became persecuted, and like Jesus himself, the Agnus Dei, which we'll see a little picture in a moment, a photo, represented the blood of Christ and the Graal. I have a slide here, if I can go forward, if it lets me. Oh, no, it doesn't. Well, one second. Where is it? Oh, it's here. So this is just for people to see. We can see it there. That's I actually took that photo at Roslyn Chapel, and that's the Agnus Dei that we see there, the Lamb of God. And the Templars took that as one of their main symbols, because Jesus supposedly, and of course in Gnosticism we have a different view. Some believe that he did die on a cross, some that he didn't, but he was persecuted nonetheless. And the Templars would endure persecution. In fact, it is part of what their beliefs, and to endure persecution, so they would become the Agnus Dei indeed. Going back to the first slide that we have here. So Gnosticism for me is relevant to this green language of initiation and the Templars' belief, because it uses symbolism and it concerns the mysteries. And symbolism is the language of the mysteries, the Western esoteric tradition, which some people call the occult. And unfortunately, that has obtained a rather negative connotation, and people tend to think of the devil and such things, which this could not be further from the truth. It just, occult simply means hidden, that which is hidden. And unfortunately, you had to hide these things for your life, because the poor tragic Cathars, 1 million of them, were wiped, and for their beliefs. The good men, the bonhommes, wiped by the Catholic Church. So by using these symbols, men would communicate with each other those thoughts which transcend the limitations of language. It is true that language can be very limiting. And also, this is applicable to the Freemasons, which we'll talk about later on. In Freemasonry, there is a belief that words can become corrupt, but symbols do not change in meaning. Or they do, depending on your level of initiation and the layers of symbolism, you know, which is another thing. That's something that I teach in my workshops. But you can always rely that a symbol is going to mean the same thing to everybody, regardless of the language or the culture. So that was one of the reasons. Now, let me just put the next slide. Fulcanelli is important, and his biographer, Kenneth Rainer Johnson, they claim that Gothic architecture that we see and that we attribute to groups like the Children of Solomon connected to the Knights Templar was imported and built through the Templars' knowledge of sacred geometry, and was not just an example of architectural beauty, but a three-dimensional code that contained messages in architectural form of la langue verte, the green language of initiation. Now, let me just... So basically, this green language arose from this need to mask conversations, to mask knowledge, and also to preserve it, actually, because some of this knowledge would have been considered heretical. Anything that was outside the narrative of the Church of Rome was heresy then. And of course, Gnosticism, the first, you know. So the way to also preserve this knowledge, because books were being burnt then, would be encoded in a language, not just in the stone, but also in stories, in the stories of the troubadours. The stories of the troubadours and Grail romances are not about maidens and knights going off and having a good time. They have a deeper meaning, and that's known to initiates. And that was a very safe way of preserving Gnosis. And I think, honestly, I don't know, this is a question that I want to ask you, Nathan. But I think that if this language of initiation hadn't existed and they hadn't used it in stone or in stories, Gnosis and Gnosticism as we have it today might not have survived, maybe. I wonder.
Not really, no. So it would have mostly been wiped out. So it's because of those old symbols that were able to make sense of it. It's even when a lot of stuff was destroyed, they were relying on those old symbols and old oral folk tale traditions passed on orally. It wasn't until they discovered Nag Hammadi Library they were able to identify other texts as Gnostic.
Exactly. So I think it was very important, all of this, and the Templars were doing a great job in contributing to this. So that's something that I wanted to point out. And this is what I mentioned before. There was a study of this. A lot of people, I made a post of this on Facebook, a great place to get bullied and get all sorts of people coming out of the woodwork. And people were saying that this was pseudo-history, that this doesn't exist, that there is no such thing as symbolism in architecture and all sorts of things. Well, you know, anyway, I'll just leave that there. But it does, I like this quote, it does speak at the same time to the humblest and the most cultured heart. And that's the beauty of this language of symbolism, the green language. So just as an example, and I'll make it bigger here for our viewers. So this is from the Rider-Waite, or Waite-Smith, as I prefer to call it, tarot, which has become the blueprint for most modern tarot decks in the world now. It was created by A.E. Waite and Pamela Coleman-Smith, both Freemasons of the Order of the Golden Dawn. And Pamela was in the theater as well, so she brought sort of that creative side. She did the drawings, following instructions of A.E. Waite. But the symbolism here is important because it does convey Gnosis. It is Templar symbolism. And what we see here is quite interesting. We have an M that keeps coming up in church graffiti a lot of the times, the Marian marks, the apotropaic mark, they tell us. But flip it, and what do we have? The M or the W, the Virgin. Yeah. Mercurial water. So those of us, Templar spirituality involved the chakras, involved energy work, okay? And we have the bird there, the dove is a Shekinah, huh? So, and we see what's happening there. We have an awakening. We have the rising Kundalini energy, and we have an awakening through all that's happening there. So symbolism is important. I don't know if I can flip. Oh, yeah, there. I didn't know if I could go. So these are from the same deck. Just for fun, if anybody's watching and they want to leave messages, these actually represent characters that were important to the Knights Templar. So we can see some of them there. I'm not going to give it away. And you see those two columns there, that figure is seated in between. So she's a very important figure in terms of the divine feminine. Those two columns come from the Temple of Solomon, Jachin and Boaz. And we have palm trees, which are very important. She's holding the Torah. She has the moon after her feet, but she also has a solar disk like Hathor, goddess Hathor. It's a very Gnostic, I would say, drawing there. These are just wonderful. But anyway, so this is an example of how you would have knowledge encoded here. A lot of people wouldn't get these symbols, you know, or the one where you have the magician there, which represents a Freemason with all the elements there, alchemical symbols. You have the pentagram, which is a symbol of the Star of Solomon, which was on his ring. You have him doing this as above, so below, which is it's a hermetic principle, but it's very relevant. You have the lilies of Mother Mary and the roses of Mary Magdalene, the Ouroboros, resurrection, eternity. You have a lot going on there, you know, for the initiated mind. So this is one way of how, and that's the apotropaic MWBV, Virgin, Virgo Virgin. So many ways of interpreting this mark, but certainly not a lot of people will think of Mercury, I think. So So this language of initiation that was called the language of the birds, I'll just leave that there for a minute. You can have a look at the columns there. There's quite an interesting symbolism there that's going to be in the cover of my next book. This language of the birds in French did not just encode the stone carvings that you can see in these abbeys built by Templars through Masons who are initiates themselves of the Children of Solomon, but we also see it in the arts, in painting, and in poems, like I've said. I will be actually, if I can mention it, I'll be giving a talk later this week at the London College of Psychic Studies on decoding the symbolism of the Knights Templar. So we will give the web address for anybody who wants to come and book a ticket. If you can't attend on a day, it's all online. If you book a ticket, you can watch it afterwards. So I will be leaving that with Nathan. But one thing that I want to add, and what we said before, is the tarot. Now, the tarot, I've just showed you the symbolism on the tarot. Let's go back to it. Sorry. Okay. So the tarot and playing cards first enter Europe in the late 14th century. Now, they are important because the tarot helped preserve that knowledge and Gnosticism as well. And a lot of people haven't realized this, okay? While the exact way in which this happened is unknown and debated by many scholars, we do have records in 1367 in Bern, Switzerland, of all places, which has a what? A Templar flag? As a national flag? It's one of the places that the Templars went to when they were arrested, the ones that escaped. So, curiously, we have cards that emerge in Switzerland with Gnosis on them. Coincidence? No. It was one of the many safe havens of escaping Templars. And then the playing cards and later tarot spread very rapidly across the whole of Europe, as can be seen from records, actually, of card games being banned by the church and disputes arising and all sorts of things. Now, I am a Jungian, and as you know, Carl Jung did considerable work with the tarot, and he was a Gnostic. And the tarot decks are based on this blueprint that I mentioned before, the Pamela Coleman-Smith and A. Waite deck. But it was a safe way of preserving and communicating Gnosis, filled with Templar symbolism. The essence, the emergence of these playing cards in the tarot, I don't think are a coincidence. And so, I don't think a lot of people have made the connection here when the tarot actually emerged and when the Templars officially were dissolved. But it kind of happens almost at the same time, you know? So that's kind of interesting to bear in mind, you know? So, those of you who are in the tarot, I will have more on this, so stay tuned. So, you have another question for me on my book, my upcoming book?
Yes. I was going to say, you have a, well, your upcoming, So, you're writing a book on the Knights Templar and Gnosticism called The Way of the Rose, which will explain the divine feminine and Templar spirituality. Could you please discuss a little bit about this?
Yes. So, that's the cover that I've put there. And that's the cover that I was mentioning before. It has a lot to do with Miss Matilda from before, Godfrey's aunt, and other Matildas as well, by the way. So there's a little group of Matildas there. But it's interesting because it's the oldest copy that we have of the Holy Sepulchre in the world. And it actually has tiles. It's there's a cello there of the Holy Sepulchre. This is in Italy. I'm not going to say where at the moment, just for fun, because I'm going to leave that for the book. But it was important to the Templars, and it was on a pilgrimage route. And they, in the copy of the sepulchre, they have tiles bathed in the blood of Christ from when he was tortured and whipped and so on. And apparently the Templars brought those tiles over. So that's quite interesting. Again, preserving Gnosis and preserving traditions and spirituality. And this church is quite early. It's built on a pagan site that has a connection to Mithras and bulls, and the name comes from there. I won't say much more, but I chose it because if you look at it, what do you see in that image? You see light.
You see the pillars, right? And the light.
And there's a fountain of water in the middle, which is feminine. And the light for me is feminine as well, is Sophia, the Shekinah, It's the feminine presence of God that sometimes manifests as a light as well. The temper is also known as the brotherhood of light, which is a very Essene saying as well.
Jesus. Temples of Isis also used to have the light shine in too.
Exactly. So I thought it was a really feminine image to go with it, you know, and I liked it for that. So I called it the Way of the Rose, Initiates of the Rose Lineage and Descendants of the Vine. I had to. And the prologue is going to be done by a friend of mine who is an excellent scholar, Professor Emeritus of Religious Studies, Dr. Stephen Muir. He's my mentor, friend, also lectures at the London College of Psychic Studies and in Canada. His work is amazing, so I'm very lucky that he will be doing the prologue for this. So this is going to be the first book of a trilogy of three books just on the Knights Templar. The next one will be The Way of the Stars, and then there'll be a companion book to the three of them, if I survive writing them. But this one is quite special. I gave it the title, as I said, because the path the Knights Templar followed is the Way of the Rose, as taught by Mary Magdalene, John the Baptist, and also John the Beloved and Mother Mary. So we often talk about Johannite Gnosticism and the Templars, and we forget all the other figures. And I think it's important not to forget them, because they were all following the same path. So you spoke about this recently, and I want to quote you, actually, in your I think it was the last YouTube that you did, so I'm reading for you. But talking about John 19:26 to 27, he expresses Jesus's care and concern for his mother. And when Jesus saw his mother there and a disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that time on, this disciple took her into his home. The unnamed disciple whom Jesus addressed was the Apostle John himself. For me, he was saying, he was connecting them, but because they were following the same tradition, because Mary could teach John much. And then John would, of course, put out later all these wonderful texts which are included in Johannite Gnosticism. But I think that's a key moment. And I wanted to mention that because you have mentioned it and it's often overlooked. The divine feminine is important for the Templars because we see all these women coming up. And actually, even today in Moses, I don't know what you will say about that series, but when they're saved from the waters, you know, from the Egyptians chasing after them in the water, so the split, and they're saved. The first one to say anything and to actually sing a song to God is Mariam, the sister of Moses. It's a woman. Ooh. It's always a woman. And they carry the grail. It's not always a woman, but you know what I mean. So I had to be a little bit naughty there. But the divine feminine was revered by the Cistercians and the Knights Templar, whose patron is Mary Magdalene, and who also showed a preference for venerating female saints like St. Helena, we've seen before, and some other ones like Catherine of Alexandria. Some connect her to Hypatia. And this famous head that's been going around that was found in the Knights Templar preceptory with a mysterious sign that people thought was the head of John the Baptist. But many scholars, among them Helen Nicholson, is adamant that it's the head of Saint Euphemia, who died, there she is, supposedly mauled by a bear, not a lion, but okay, in a Roman circus, martyred. So that's what they did to Christians, you know, and followers of the true faith, unfortunately. So she was a virgin martyr who died for her faith in 303 AD. So she died because she was refusing to offer sacrifices to Ares. And she was arrested and suffered various tortures. Her tomb later became a site of pilgrimages. I think she's important to the Templars, and there was a thing back then for venerating heads. So it wasn't that the Templars were just venerating the head of John the Baptist. There was a whole cult at that time period for venerating heads and other bits of saints as relics. Let's just say that, you know. But I think she was inspiring to them because she stood by her beliefs, like the Cathars, and died for them, you know. And the Templars did too. The Templars did too. You know, it was just a few weeks ago, we were remembering Jacques de Molay being burnt on the 18th of March, you know, 1314, just outside Notre Dame. That must have been tough, you know, for a 70-year-old man to have been in prison for so many years and end like that. And he stood there and he took it and, you know, he died in the noblest way possible, not complaining, not, you know, admirable. But anyway, the first evidence we have of this reverence for the divine feminine is actually in written form. And we find this, I want to put a picture of him. We find it in a Latin rule of the Knights Templar. Now, I've done a little video, which I'm going to share in a moment to make it more palatable for our viewers, because this is heavy stuff, and it'll be easier to digest if they see it in a video. But Bernard, we see him there in an image that's quite famous. It's called Delectation of Saint Bernard. And it's believed that the Virgin Mary squirted 3 drops of her breast of milk into his mouth like that. And after that, he had the gift of second sight and he was able to perform miracles. And he was obsessed with the Virgin to a point where it was almost not normal. Worrying, especially in the ages they lived with all the heretical stuff going on. The Templars had a thing for the Black Madonnas. Now, we'll get into that at some other time, but he was such an avid Marianist that he preached the Second Crusade from the Virgin of Vezelay, a Black Madonna there. And that's quite interesting. And he would write the Templars' rule, the Latin rule, which contains the spirituality of the Templars, but it contains the reasons why the Templars revered the divine feminine. For me, honestly, if I'm honest, I think that one of the jobs of the Templars, which we'll see, tell us, they've left records because we do have the originals of the rule, was to protect and defend not just Mary, but the divine feminine. They were protectors and defenders of the divine feminine, because for the Templars, like in Gnosticism, God was male and female. We were created in the likeness of God. So if we were created in the likeness of God, God is not just a male. No. Otherwise, there would be no girls. So, no. And this would not be such a fun place. Anyway. On with that. I have the video here if I'd like to, if I can share. Yes? Okay. little video there. Lots of symbolism there, especially the end as well. So divine feminine. Women and the feminine are key to understanding Templar spirituality and what they were about. I mentioned the Grail romances before, which also embody the green language of initiation. And in these romances, we often see women representing truth, purity of heart in carrying the Grail, regardless of the Grail being a cup or a dish or a whatever people want it to be, you know, but women are always seen next to or carrying the Grail. I think that's quite important. These women or the beloved are not really women, though, in these Grail stories. They are the feminine aspect of wisdom, Sophia, in Gnosticism, which had been deleted from history and from the world, the feminine face of God, and therefore part of the ancient teachings and belief prior to the Church of Rome. This is part of the true mission, as I mentioned, of the Templars. And they tell us this. They tell us this in their own Templar rule right there. So, we're not blind, but it's also encoded in all these languages. Now, we also see this idea. I wanted to share something today that isn't so well known. We see this idea in the love poetry of the Fedeli di Amore. I'm going to put another slide for this, sorry. I'll just put it here. So that's Dante Alighieri there that we see on the left. He is from the same time period as the Templars. And I actually have it here. I received a copy of his Divine Comedy, which is quite a difficult book for a seven-year-old when I was seven. And this is that old, so over 40 years old, and it has come with me everywhere in Italian from the 1300s. So, but it was quite a key book because it is actually a manual of initiation into the Western esoteric tradition and Gnosis. A lot of people might not have heard of Dante being associated in this way, but the first one who did a study on this, or one of the first, would have been that man, the father of his. The man we see there on the right is pre-Raphaelite painter and poet Dante Gabriel Rossetti. His father, Gabriele, who was exiled from Italy in London for his very controversial political ideas, would have been one of the first to actually look at Dante's work. Never mind the rest of the group that he was colleagues with and was part of. The Fedeli di Amore, which I'll talk about in a minute. But Dante Gabriele's father, Gabriele, looked at his work and he realized that these poets and Dante were talking about these women that they were in love with, but they were talking about them in a very strange way. They didn't feel like women of the flesh. They felt very ethereal, very sort of divine. That they couldn't touch them, you know, dreamlike. And it was very awkward, the language that they used. So inhuman, in a way. He studied their work in depth and influenced also by the Greek writer Ugo Foscolo, Rossetti arrived at a very surprising theory that the love poetry of Dante in this group called the Fedeli di Amore, the loyal to love, was not merely romantic, but served as a veneer for secret communications of a clandestine group, the Fedeli di Amore, which was made up by poets of the Stil Novo movement. And what this group was doing, apparently, or who they were, in time, he believed that they were actually modern successors to the ancient mystery cults, particularly the Pythagorean tradition, and positioning themselves as wisdom initiates opposed to the Catholic Church, preserving Gnosis. So in reality, the Fedeli di Amore, and there hasn't been a lot of work in English done on this. I'm fluent in Italian, so I will be working on this, and it will be my upcoming work. They were actually an artistic branch of the Knights Templar. and a mystery school. They were born out of the Templar tradition, and the church then went, because it was interrogating, torturing, and we had the Inquisition and so on, they had to hide because of the times, but they used letters, love letters from one another, talking about these women, but they were not talking about the women, they were talking about Holy Sophia, you know, and things in code. So I think that's quite interesting. So this new wave of poetry is known as Istil Nava as well. And what it is, it's very similar to Sufi poetry, because by praising the beloved in religious terms as an embodiment of divine grace, and influenced by the troubadour poetry that I mentioned before, they were actually approaching God in a very mystical way through gnosis. That's what they were doing. So this circle of poets is, by the way, I'll mention them, Dante Alighieri, Guido Cavalcanti, Lapo Gianni, Cino da Pistoia, and Cecco d'Ascoli. And they worked together in a very unconventional approach to love poetry, dedicating their works to a muse who was neither their wife or a conventional romantic partner, echoing the concept of courtly love that we see with the troubadours and Eleanor of Aquitaine's courtly or court of love. The beloved woman, therefore, in the works of these poets, serves to secretly designate the sect to which they belong. As lovers of true wisdom, whose purity opposes the worldly corruption of the church. So, we're talking about a platonic spiritual love overlooked by many. These poets are actually speaking of the highest form of love theorized by Plato, the love for Sophia, which in Greek is wisdom, as we know. So Dante Alighieri's love for Beatrice and the love that these poets share for their women represent the heavenly intelligence. It personifies holy wisdom, the divine intelligence, whose veneration dates back to antiquity, to the Pythagorean mysteries, being at the center of a secret doctrine through which the soul of the adept is in love with, similarly to the beloved of the Sufis, like in Sufi poetry. So Dante's Beatrice, actually, people have identified her with a woman called Beatrice Portinari, who's a daughter of a banker. But actually, if I can fast forward, and we see Beatrice here, there we go, that's Beatrice Portinari, quite a nice little image there. And then later on, she's painted by Dante Gabriele Rossetti. So these are the pictures in the 1800s of supposedly what he imagined Beatrice would be like. But actually, there's a poem. Oh, I missed it. Sorry. It's here. There. So Dante was inspired by the troubadours in this poem. This is the Calenda Maya. It's an actual troubadour poem. And if you see that arrow there, I'm marking it there, Lady Beatrice. It's already there. And actually, Beatrice is a Templar name for girls. I'll comment on that. We see it a lot. It means bringer of happiness. So, among other things. But what's interesting is, why have I just put that poem there as well? Well, if you go to Dante's Divine Comedy, you'll find 8 verses in Occitan, the Languedoc of the troubadours, in the Divine Comedy. So he gives us a lot of clues, okay? But for me, Dante, and I'll just share this, these are from his book. The last one, which I shared with you before, this quote is very Gnostic. Alone, you know yourself. Known to yourself, you knowing love and smile on your own being. Know thyself. That comes from there. So this is one of the other ways that we see the preservation of Gnosis and Gnosticism in the works of these poets who are the Templar artistic branch, but also they're connected to the Rosicrucians. And I'll speak about that later on. And I thought it was important to share that here today, because we're going to talk about them. So Nathan, before we go on, I'd like to add something. So we just were looking at Dante and that wonderful quote about knowing yourself. And I'd like to add something to this. This quote first appeared in a temple of Apollo at Delphi, according to the Greek writer Pausanias, but actually came from Luxor in Egypt and was around long before Socrates. So, and also we see it, it appears in the Art of War from ancient China, Sun Tzu's, but there's a lot of debate on this of where it came from and, you know, who said it first. But I do want to, because we are talking about Gnosticism today, it's important to mention that it is in the Gospel of Thomas, where he wrote one of Jesus' teachings saying, "You will understand everything when you know yourself." And I think that is very true. Today has been one of those days. I don't think I know everything about everything or everything about myself, but I felt different today, that certainly that saying holds true in many ways.
100%. So, Helena, for this next question, could you please share your knowledge on the Johannite Gnostics and the mystery tradition of ancient esoteric groups such as the Druids, the Cathars, and perhaps any other groups that might have influenced the Templars' unique spirituality?
Yes, I'm going to have to take over and share the screen again, if that's okay.
That's okay.
Take the power. 1 second. So... so going back to my wonderful slides here. So I've done a few little slides here. It'll be easy. So the first thing that I want to do before I even get into that, if I'm allowed, is just have our viewers look at, if they can see, because that bar is annoying me at the bottom there. I think they can see it anyway. The name of the Templars, right? I've just put it there for everybody to have a look at. What's in a name? Because that gives us a very big clue of the spirituality of the Templars. So we see it in French there, okay? The poor fellow soldiers of Christ and the Temple of Solomon in English underneath. But what does this mean? Okay, so let's split it up. Poor fellow soldiers, okay, right? Okay, they're poor maybe. Soldiers, okay, of Christ. Right, that's the first clue. Who is Christ? Because Jesus is a Christ, sure, but Christ, the term, existed way before Jesus. Christ, as I see it, is an anointed one. The anointed one, but also the other definition is an initiate. So for me, now this term, this name of the Templar starts to change. So it's the fellow soldiers, the poor fellow soldiers of the initiate or the anointed one and of the Temple of Solomon, which we'll see in a minute why the Temple of Solomon was so very important to the Knights Templar. But initiate gives us a clue. Initiate of who or what? So the Templars themselves were initiates, okay? Jesus was an initiate of the older traditions which were taught to him by Mary Magdalene, by John the Baptist, and by his mother. Mary Magdalene and his mother, Mother Mary, would both have been priestesses in temples. And in fact, the name Mary, which later became a name, was also a title, like Christ. Mm. And Mary, Mari, as many of the Egyptian goddesses were known, Mari Hathor, Mari Isis, was a title for priestess. So, that tells us a lot. So before I get into anything else, I wanted to mention that, okay? Let me just get out of here, sorry, and go to the next slide. I don't know why it doesn't let me sometimes. There, okay. So I'll just have to do it manually, forgive me. So this one's important. Let me just put that there. Okay, so... when we're talking about the, what did the Templars believe in? Okay, were they Catholic? Were they Muslim? Were they Jewish? Were they Cathar? Were they, what the hell were they? So we know now that they were initiates of something, okay? But to understand what they believed in, we have to look at who their families were, and we also have to look at their actual position within the order to understand a little bit, okay? So I would agree with this quote. According to French scholars, these two French scholars, the order of the temple was indeed made out of seven exterior circles dedicated to the minor mysteries, I have a clue there, and of three interior circles. 10 is important, so numbers are important, numerology, and the mysteries, corresponding to the initiation into the great mysteries, the major arcana. This nucleus was composed of 70 Templars. This is what these two scholars tell us, which I agree with. I agree with. So what does that mean? Well, the inner circles would have been made up by those who were in charge of the Templars, right? Yes? So for me, those who would have been in the upper circles would have been Gnostic, holy Gnostic, from the Rexdale's families, from those Vine families. And they would have practiced Gnosticism in many ways, influenced by what I'm going to speak about next. But the ones who were sergeants, who were had minor jobs for the order, who had just come into the order, who had just been initiated into the order, some of them would have been Catholic, sure. Others would have been Jews, or Muslim even, depending on the country they were. So we cannot say that the Templars were just this or just that. We have to look at the level within the order. And in those upper circles, which I mentioned were mostly descendants of the Vine, of the initial founding knights of the bloodline, or also sometimes families, noble families who would have had an outstanding record, but would have been Gnostic. In that inner core, the traditions would have probably varied a little bit depending on where they were. For example, Bernard de Clairvaux's mother was Cather. And a lot of people don't know that Stephen Harding, his predecessor, was a Kabbalist. And he was very much into the Celtic Church as well. So his spirituality wasn't Catholic either. They came from Cluny. And they would have been, I'll get into that when I speak about the symbolism of the Templars. But what's important is to understand that their particular traits that they would have followed, like Harding and Bernard wouldn't have been on the same page with everything, even though they were both Cistercian and they were both not of the Catholic faith. So it's important to understand that. But bearing in mind that if we take a step back, the bigger picture, the core of the order was Gnostic. So, and their purpose, their activities were Gnostic, the preservation of knowledge and the restoration of the divine feminine. So it's important to understand that. Now, what is Gnosticism? For those who don't understand or don't know, and not that I'm an expert, of course I'm not. I'm here with an expert, So, Father Nathan, I've done this little diagram there just to explain a little bit. That's kind of how I see it. But within there can be lots of variances. And there are many, many Gnostic groups, as you know, in the history of Gnosticism as well. You know, we can even, some of the older ones, like the Mandeans, who also would have influenced the Templars. And, of course, they're Johannites, they follow the John the Baptist. The Mandeans are all about baptism in the water. They're the oldest and longest surviving Gnostics, uninterrupted survival. The last of the ancient Gnostics, I would say. Persecuted as well, and in danger of becoming extinct, I would say. But they have influenced the Templars as well. So all of these groups here and faiths here, because some are faiths, Islam, you know, Judaism, Christianity. Classical paganism as well. We have the Eleusinian mysteries, cult of Isis. We have the Mithras cults as well. So all of these have played a part. So, but actually, the Templar rule tells us what the Templars believed in. It tells us if we go to it. And we see it here. Rule number 9, they operate as a canonical institution, but they also have their own path of spirituality within the Templar priesthood. They have their own holy communion. They're described as having this religion, their own religion of knighthood, which was a new type of religion. But not only that, they're officially founded where? In the Temple of Solomon. So what's in their name? Initiates of Christ in the Temple of Solomon, okay? And the first founding knights would have spent 9 years there. Well, 9 founding knights or 11, I believe there are 11. The first initial founding knights would have spent 9 years in the Holy Land digging under the Temple Mount, not protecting pilgrims, which is a misconception. And we owe that to wonderful William of Tyre and historians who have parroted that to death. But actually, the Templars did no pilgrim protection. But certainly not the first 9 years. I can tell you that. Nobody ever saw them. And there is no evidence that they did that, or any documents, and we had the Hospitallers who did that job.
I was going to mention about the Hospitallers.
Yes, so they were created for that job specifically. Yes, later on they did engage in some pilgrim protection, and actually I always say that the way they protected pilgrims was through diplomacy. They signed agreements, like with the assassins and other Muslim leaders. They were smart. They weren't going to go around fighting in guerrilla warfare tactics in a desert, you know, and to be eaten by mountain lions. Come on, you know, they were smarter than that. So King Solomon's temple is actually an Egyptian pharaonic temple, and it embodies the ancient Magi priesthood of Melchizedek. So bearing in mind that this is an Egyptian temple, I said to you today, talking, that the 3 major Abrahamic religions of the world were influenced by Egypt. Indeed, going back to Moses again, which is stuck in my brain after watching that Netflix thing. Sigmund Freud wrote a book on Moses, and he actually believed that Moses was Egyptian. So that's interesting. But Egypt is important when it comes to the Gnosis that the Templars follow and practice, and even from the Templars through the Rosicrucians to the Freemasons later on as well. Very, very important. So what is interesting is that those rules there, 65, 66, and 279 and 630, you actually can understand why they had Jews and Muslims and Christians and Catholics and Gnostics. Because the order was interfaith. It would be really nice if we had some Templars watching this, modern Templars, and actually listen to this, because I have seen some modern Templar orders who are for Catholics only. And that for me is the most bizarre thing I've ever seen, given in mind what the Catholic Church did to the Templars and what the Templars stood for. So anyway, I will never understand certain things. So we see that the Templar rule of the Templars, if we go into it, and you can all get a copy. Actually, if I can mention it, I have a Patreon account, and you can follow me for free. But there's also perks if you get a membership. But in my Patreon, I have downloadable documents, and one of them is the Templar rule, the whole damn rule. You know, over 200 articles. So if you've got time and you want to really get down to knowing what was going on, download it and have a read, okay? So their spirituality is classified by the reverence of the divine feminine aspect of God. We've seen that. And that's part of Gnosticism as well. Individual daily prayer and a direct experience of God. As opposed
to... something that can help with your support your argument as well, which shows the Templars were indeed Gnostic. It was one of their rituals they would do, and it was to stay in a coffin for 3 days, and it was to symbolize dying and rising. And that's, again, Gnostic.
Exactly, exactly. And you know what? That is part of Freemasonry as well.
Okay, cool.
So when you are, in Freemasonry, the first 3 degrees, okay, when you become a Master Mason and you are risen, you're declared risen, is because of that awakening resurrection ritual, which was practiced throughout history. And the Golden Dawn had a box called Pastos, and the initiates would spend 3 days in there. Remember that we were talking about the 3 drops of liquid of milk that Bernard de Clairvaux gets from the Virgin Mary? 3 is a key number. And even Jesus, if we go back to this ritual, to supposedly Jesus spending 3 days in his tomb and not really dying. So there's a lot there that I could comment on that, but I won't today. But thank you for that. That's a really good point that you made. And that's great. Yes, that's very, very important. Individual day prayer, direct experience of God. Well, I think that's the whole, core of Gnosticism, a direct experience. Frequent spiritual meditation and vocal chanting. Music is very important. I work with music in history. And the Knights Templar and the Templar rule, I have another slide here, I can show it in a minute. But it was enshrined that they had to study what they called the 7 sacred sciences or noble arts, and alchemy being one of them and music being another. And of course, we have Gregorian chant, which affects our awareness, and that's developed by the Templars as well. So esoteric energy work and spiritual alchemy involving the chakras. So that's the symbols that we saw before in the tarot. The Templars did work and in fact, they would build churches on earth chakras, on sacred geography sites. So that's very important. And of course, metaphysical science, exploring spiritual energies. So a lot of people would say, and they've said this to me as well, oh my God, you're mixing New Age with the Templars. Stop. We have real history. There's no need for that. These are the things that they said to me. And I'm like, I'm not making this up. You can actually research this. And it's not New Age, as you know, Nathan, but all of these things are part of Gnosticism in a very, very old age. So not really, but, for people who don't know, So this is really interesting. I had this document on the screen before we went on today, and I was looking at it because it's in Latin. And in English, obviously, they've done the English translation. Now, for those of you who don't know Latin, this is going to be hard. But I always say, as a linguist, because I'm a translator, I don't trust relying on translations. And when I watch a movie, I prefer to get the original version if I can, because things get lost in translation. Now, if you look at that paragraph that I have there in the bottom of the screen, okay, so this is a papal bull of 1139, which if you go to it, you can look at it online, or I have it in my vault, you can download it. You've got the text in Latin and the text in English. The text in Latin has been translated into English, okay? You see there, that papal bull of 1139 refers to the Templars having their own religion, Vestra Religio, okay? Vestra. In Italian would be vostra, in French, votre. So the Romance languages is very easy from the Latin to see it. That was translated into English by somebody, not as your own religion, but as your order, as the order. It's important when we're looking at history to go to primary sources because of this, because you get mistranslations. So that papal bull is already referring to the Templars having their own version of religion that is not the same as the Catholic Church. You can see it there. So influences, before I rattle on. So I've talked about Egypt before, but we also see a sign often, a Greek sign, the Alpha and the Omega, with the Templar the end and the beginning. And for me, that has a lot to do with the beginning, which the beginning of all recorded religion is in Mesopotamia. We have Shamash, the sun god, wearing the Templar cross, which is not Templar. Obviously, they weren't around then, but it's a solar sign. It's a solar cross, you know, it's a solar symbol. Mesopotamia and Egypt are very important. Comes to the beliefs that have been handed down in Gnosticism, I think, and to the Templars as well. The Pythagoreans, the Pharaonic Egyptian mysteries, the cult of Isis, the Persian cult of Mithras, the Eleusinian mysteries, which are the pagan sort of Western esoteric tradition, Druidism, the Druids. The Druids I didn't get into today, but the divine feminine was key for the Druids. So that's one of the aspects. And in fact, one of Pythagoras' teachers was Druid. Anybody who was anybody at that time when Jesus was around and afterwards would have gone to study in Egypt. And in fact, Gnosticism, we can see that the origins of Gnosticism as such would have been with the Hellenized Jews living in Egypt, in Alexandria. So we go back to Egypt. Sufism, the religion of love of the Sufis and the beloved that we mentioned before, who is not really a woman, but is this divine aspect of God. Sevenfoldedness, as in the book of Revelation by John. Now, scholars and mystics found that Revelation of St. John was a new system of Christian initiation. And what were the Templars initiates of?
Gnostics or Gnosis.
Yes, but they were initiates. So there you go. So sevenfoldedness is important to them. And in numerology, seven is a very key important number. But why? Well, four was a number that was used to refer to God, but also the earth, because God made the earth on the fourth day. And four is seen as physical as well, and man. And three is a number of the spirit. So four and three equals seven, which is what we are. We are body, physical, and spirit. So Manichaeism and Catharism and other Gnostic groups, the Nazareans, the Mandians, the Druze. And then I mentioned before the Western esoteric tradition. So the Templars, in essence, were dualist Gnostic initiates. And then in modern tradition, now we can do another YouTube about that some other day, but Johannite Gnosticism in modern times, for me, which emerged with this church that was set up in the 1800s by Fabre Palaprat, and he claimed to be one of the descendants of the vine and be in this lineage of grand masters that was created in a charter called the Larminius Charter, which I won't say if it's a forgery, not a forgery, I'm not going to go into that, but there is a document that exists. Some people believe it to be fake, some believe it to be real, that listed all the grand masters. And this grand master, Palaprat, would have been the last one. He created the Johannite Church in France, in the beginning of France, in the beginning of the 1800s. And that led to the Johannite Church that we have today. So a lot of Templar orders, I believe, modern ones, are affiliated to that. I don't know them. I know that they follow the teachings of John, which would be correct. But for me, the Templars followed more than that. Essentially, Gnosticism, not limited to John the Baptist. John the Baptist was very important to them, but so were the teachings of Mary Magdalene, Mother Mary, even Thomas, the Gospel of Thomas, I think is very important. So that's what I have to say on that. We have one last question. We have time?
Yes. Could you please explain your thoughts on the Rosicrucians and the Freemasons being heirs to the Templar traditions?
Yes. So the Rosicrucians, I mentioned Dante before, Dante Alighieri, and I don't know if I have any slides here. Oops, no. We've gone dark. Switch the light. Sorry. Techno peasant here. So Dante Alighieri was, I feel like I have the Templars with me, or Philippe Lebel or someone like that. I don't know. Just to continue, but just to make it fun for those who are watching, when I was doing my In Remembrance talk about the Knights Templar on Friday the 13th, of all days, 20 minutes before I began my lecture with a whole group of people, my laptop went like that out of the desk and slid on the floor, and pieces went everywhere. 20 minutes before I had this talk. So I stole my son's laptop. I downloaded Zoom on that, and I was able to get online. I couldn't access my presentation, but I sort of winged it with a couple of videos, and I knew it off the top of my head, you know, but it was really funny. And we joked, because a lot of people had issues that night and logging on and all of that, that Philippe Lebel was there, and they were trying to stop us from remembering the Templars and honoring them. Well, I don't know, something's going on tonight, because there's something going on. But anyway, so Dante Alighieri, that I mentioned before, for me, can be seen as a bridge between the Templars and the Rosicrucians. Now, the Rosicrucians, a lot of people think that they began in the early 17th century. And essentially, they were a legendary and mysterious secret society, very, very secret. But there's three sort of texts that they associate with this, and one of this famous chemical wedding of Christian Rosenkreutz, all texts from the 1600s, manifestos, that claim to reveal the existence of a secret brotherhood of alchemists. Remember alchemy, I mentioned alchemy was very important to the Knights Templar, in their spirituality, to study it. So a brotherhood of alchemists and mystics who possessed esoteric knowledge and aimed to transform society through spiritual enlightenment. Now, for me, that's pretty much the mission of the Templars, because they did have Gnosis. They were Gnostics. They were trying to restore the world to a better state by bringing back the feminine and the forgotten knowledge. And they were on a spiritual quest themselves of the Grail, to become better versions of themselves, to be able to serve those around them and the world in a better way, and to make this world a better place. That's what I feel the Templars were doing. And the Rosicrucians, pretty much the same. Pretty much the same. So these manifestos that were published gained attention then and sparked a fascination with alchemy, mysticism, and the occult across Europe. And the movement's teachings blended elements of Hermeticism, Kabbalah, Christian mysticism, and alchemy. The figure of Christian Rosenkreutz, the legendary founder of the Rosicrucian Order, was portrayed as a wise and enlightened sage who had traveled to the East to learn this ancient wisdom. Some people believe he's made up. He never existed, you know. Other scholars believe that the Rosicrucians began much earlier. And much earlier, I mean, around about the time of when the Templars stopped being the Templars. And when the, for example, these the bridge would have been people like the Fedeli d'Amore and people like that, groups like that. So 1300s, more or less, to be precise, which is quite a few centuries earlier than the official version that we get told. Now, I mentioned before about the wine with the Knights Templar and why they were connected. And we can see Rosicrucians and the Freemasons as being offshoots of that vine from Jesus' family, from the bloodline. They come from the same source. Poured in different glasses, but they come from the same source. Same vine. So, better metaphor than that. But in modern times, they have become separated from each other. And it is important to see what their teachings were. Now, Dante, going back to Dante's writings and his Divine Comedy that I mentioned before, there's various themes in there that resonate with Rosicrucian philosophy and Templar as well. What themes am I talking about? So, spiritual transformation, A journey of the soul through the afterlife and a search for divine wisdom, Holy Sophia. Ooh, that's very Gnostic. So we can see the inheritance here. These all align with Rosicrucian ideals, and they're a continuation of Templar spirituality and themes. Dante's incorporation of alchemical symbolism as well. So he has alchemical symbolism in his drawings and esoteric knowledge. So some people have said that he was a Rosicrucian already, as early as that. I see them as a bridge, okay? And his colleagues, the Fedeli, the Amori, the poets. So they carried within them the mysteries of the Templars and of the blood of Christ, and continued the legacy in spreading the knowledge and the teachings so that Gnosis would not be forgotten. That's the main mission of the Templars, as I mentioned before. But that's really what the Rosicrucians were doing. Now, when it comes to the Freemasons, and before I go on to the Freemasons, I want to add something that's really interesting. A lot of people don't know this, but this is just to prove the connection or just add some more context to it. But when the Templars were arrested in 1307 in France, a lot of people don't know that Dante Alighieri, who wrote the Divine Comedy, was in France, in Paris, then for 2 whole years. And we know this. He was there for other reasons, supposedly for commercial reasons, but we know this because a later writer, Boccaccio, tells us this. And Dante's own son, Peter, also tells us that Dante was in Paris. Now, what is really interesting and sort of the nail in the coffin here is that Dante was buried in a Templar church in Ravenna, Italy. So that's a very big telltale sign. But anyway, so going from them and leaving the Knights Templar to one side for a minute, we can see how Rosicrucian ideas and Templar ideas through the Rosicrucians would have influenced the development of Freemasonry, especially in terms of the ritualistic practices, the symbolism. The symbolism is always there in Gnosticism, in the Templars, and in the Rosicrucians, in Freemasonry, in the organizational structure. So Freemasonry, what is it? Well, it's a brotherly organization like the Templars. It's a fraternal organization, not a faith, not a church. The Templars were also not a faith or a church. It's important to say that. With medieval roots in the stonemason guilds. So you have the stonemason guilds in France, the Compagnonnage, the children of Father Soubise, Master Jacques, and the children of Solomon. And these evolved from operative masons, into speculative Freemasonry, or Masonry rather. And we see this, for example, in the case of the Mother Lodge of Scotland, the Grand Mother Lodge of Scotland in Kilwinning. Now, the origins of that lodge date back to 1160. That's before the Templars were arrested. So we see that there is a transition from the builders of these churches, where some would have gone into speculative Freemasonry, especially in Scotland. In England, it happens much later. But that is a little bit how Freemasonry evolved. Now, there is no one way, because Freemasonry evolved at the same time, or almost at the same time, in a variety or a number of places. So Ireland and Scotland almost similarly. And we have in the northern France, we have the Jacobean rite Freemasonry as well. Now, the Masonic Lodge in England wouldn't have happened until the 1700s. So that's much later. Okay. So, but I will get into that another day. And I will be discussing that in my books. But we can see, again, if we remember the vine, that there is a continuation and flow of ideas from one to the other. So I hope that I haven't ranted on too much and that I've explained a little bit how everything comes together. But the main ingredient here with all of these groups that we've talked about today, Templars, Freemasons, Rosicrucians, and even the Gnostic groups, is Gnosis. It's always been there. It's the core ingredient for all of them. And I think it's something really important. And nowadays, too, if I'm allowed to add something, I have no interest in supporting any groups or being against anybody, even the Catholic Church. You know, I'm just a neutral historian, but I see how things have developed. And I was baptized a Roman Catholic. But I don't like labels. I'm like the Templars. I don't like being boxed into any category. I have to say that as I've studied history and I've gotten to know history and also the faiths, I've studied Buddhism, I've studied Christianity, I've studied a lot of different faiths, Judaism, Kabbalah, you know, all sorts of things. Gnosis, knowledge, has gotten me to where I am today. And I am forever grateful for that. And I fully support what the Gnostic Union is doing and Gnosticism as well. I think it's for people nowadays, Carl Jung said it back in his day, and I think he was a visionary. He realized that the faiths or churches as we've had, Catholic and Protestant, both of them, you know, were not somehow enough for people. And people were struggling, they were having their problems, depression, everyday issues, and the church that was always there for them was not there for them anymore. So I think Gnosticism is why people say nowadays, well, I'm not religious, but I'm spiritual. Well, we owe that to Carl Jung, but we also actually owe it to the ancient Gnostic groups and fathers. Because without them, without the Templars, without the poor Cathars, without all of these people who endured, we wouldn't be spiritual and not religious.
Mm.
Spiritual beings, right?
Yeah. And we wouldn't have half the rights we do now. Women would be a lot more suppressed. We're getting
there, hopefully. Hopefully that can improve for women, because we still don't have that there. But
unfortunately.
For me, certainly learning about Gnosticism and everything that is entailed in history and the work I do in research has been my rock. And I think it's an answer to a lot of people, because unfortunately, their systems of belief that they had till today, I think are not enough, unfortunately. So not that I'm trying to convert anybody or anything. But I did have a question for you before we go, if that is okay.
Yeah, that's fine.
Are you on the spot? So, having said this, Nathan, what would you say to people who are interested in Gnosticism? How can they learn more? And how can Gnosticism actually help them with everything that we have going on today in their own individual journeys and spiritual paths?
Well, I find Gnosticism is great for the individual. Most people in life want to be told how to live. So for someone like that, Gnosis is a bit of a struggle because it's their own individual path. It's about searching within. Those that are new to Gnosticism, I would encourage to read their text. But not just read them, but sit down with them and ask, what does this mean to me? What does it mean to the spirit within? Using logic and reason. And this can be a great help because, again, using logic and reason is what makes us human. Otherwise, we're being not using our intelligence. So living knowledge that we can enact and use into our life instead of dead, useless knowledge that we can't use. So I would say that's what makes it beneficial into our lives. So we're able to enact it and encourage us to be our authentic selves.
I agree. I think being inquisitive and questioning everything really, really is a way of learning and the way forward. I was always the annoying child. But why? Still am. Haven't changed, you know. I go to lectures or whatever and have the annoying one that's putting up her hand up and asking things. That quote that I put in that little Divine Feminine video, those who find me find happiness. Sophia, wisdom. I totally agree. I'm not there yet completely, but I'm happier because I have found some wisdom. So That's what I'll add. So thank you for today and for having me on here. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you so much for joining as well. I'll mention some end discussions, but before I do as well, for those that are new to Gnosticism as well, I'd also encourage them to seek out someone like you or me as well, other people who speak about it, so that way they can get different viewpoints, not just one. So yes. It's great to seek out all different people and study history.
Yes, and I have to say, I've watched a few episodes of your YouTube, and I think you're doing a great job. So, you know, well done with that. Keep on doing it. They're fun to watch as well. You know, you wouldn't expect it. I'm having a lot of fun with the little add-ons that you put on and the little gifs and the little cartoons and things. They're very entertaining, but they're very, very informative as well. So keep on doing that. And thank you again.
Okay, Helena. I'll quickly read this end discussion mentions as well. As Helena has an upcoming online talk at the London College of Psychic Studies on decoding the symbolism of the Knights Templar, which you mentioned before. This will be held on the 4th of April in London time. Ticket purchasers will get a link to a live recording whether or not they attend on the day. It will not be available for those who have not purchased tickets. We will provide the link in the video description and in the comment section too for those who are interested. And you can catch Helena on all social media, YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and also on her Patreon, where you can follow her and support her, but also get exclusive access to her work and really neat perks, including free downloadable material, access to lectures, talks, and discussions, and sneak peeks, and much more. I highly recommend to check her out on Facebook and YouTube.